I'm Wade Price, and although I know a picture paints 1,000 words, I also know it's much more expensive and takes an awful lot longer. That's why, today, here to talk about the art of the 41st millennium is Warhammer 40,000 studio illustrator, Phil Moss. Hey, Phil.
Alright, Wade.
How you doing?
Not bad, you sir?
I'm very good, thank you. Thank you very much for joining us for VoxCast.
My pleasure.
So this is you are the first representative of the illustrator team, the art team.
I'm representing.
Representing the Warhammer 40,000 Studios art team here on VoxCast. Thank you very much.
Pleasure.
So what's your story, Phil? We tend to do this as the kind of introduction to VoxCast. What is your tragic origin story? How did you discover Warhammer?
Ooh, how far do you want to go back?
How did we discover Warhammer?
Yeah. I think how it started was a mate of mine and my brother's in the village we grew up in, for some reason had like a little lead Terminator figure, and I can never understand why we thought that was more interesting than like an action man or a big monster thing, but it was. I think it's good to paint them yourselves. So because they had one, we had to go and buy one, and that started to be a bit cool. And then I came across a White Dwarf magazine in newsagents. A little town near us, and it, you know, next to tractors and PC hardware and and homeware and whatever, there was this angel of death with a hairdryer on fire, just shooting things. I thought that was mint. So yeah, it was a great piece of artwork, really.
Do you remember what issue of White Dwarf that was?
Well, I think it's like 183 or something like that. It's Jeff Taylor. Jeff Taylor's Angels of Death cover from White Dwarf 183 in September. Probably 19 something and young. So it sounds really trite, but yeah, it was a big piece of artwork, really, that got me into it. And then me and my brother and these two mates of ours, but we kept on a bit more than they did. We just churned through it, got one of everything. Every time a game system came out, we jumped on it so we could play all the games and environments and the narratives and whatever. Yeah. It was just fun.
Was there a Games Workshop store around here? It sounds like you're out in the wilds, somewhere rural.
Yeah, deepest, darkest Staffordshire.
Okay.
So we had a few little hobby stores in our local town. One of them was called Lads and Dads. For my brother, it was just lads. lads and their mum. So there was a few little hobby stores, mainly sort of trains and motor control cars and that sort of stuff, which we were never particularly into. And then as that went on, a proper devoted to a gaming hobby store set up. And our nearest workshop store was in Stoke, in Hanley.
Right.
Stoke represented.
Yeah. Back in those days, it was like the community was a more far-flung thing, and you had to find
definitely. It was much more of a novelty to go to a workshop store, and we'd save up our 50p's on paper rounds and whatever, and occasionally go up to Hanley to get a new dinnerware set from VHS and maybe some paints
if you were lucky.
But again, because we used to do paint sets, didn't we, with illustrated covers, and again, yeah, I think that was another Angels of Death thingy pop with hair dryers. It's cool. When Blood Angels Red was orange.
You've learned the proper names for weapons by now, though.
No.
They're all armed with hair dryers on fire.
Things. Zap, bang, and woo. Those are the different sorts.
Were there any factions in particular that drew your eye when you started off? Is there anything that's been consistently what you...
I think we started with... it was the Terminator figures, and they're still the coolest thing. And I think what cemented that at the start was you could get the little lead Terminator captain who stood there quite stocky like a breeze block and his little sword. And then in the was it second edition with the John Blanche cover, the box game, I think?
Yeah.
And in the opening page of that book, it had the portrait of the Terminator captain, they should have no fear, and it was the same guy. And I could get that with my little thick head. I was like, oh, that's that guy. And I was always the sort of person, because me and my brother read loads and loads and loads as kids, read absolutely everything. But we'd always go into the bookshops and you'd get the book with the best illustrated cover on the front, and then you'd be waiting throughout the book to find the bit where the cover matches the story.
Yep.
And if that didn't happen, I really lost my temper. So that's what I really got out of workshop stuff, is that these tokens, essentially, as much as we love the figures, match the artwork. It was they were a representation of that really cool thing. So without really knowing it at the time, it was always about the pictures and the really cool ideas that were going on.
And when did you start working on art as a possible career choice?
I don't think it really clicked that was what I wanted to do until I decided that I didn't want to do all the other things.
Yeah, that sounds like an exhaustive list to work
through.
That
are on the table at school. Yeah. You know, I'm not interested in that. I don't like counting. If it was involved in telling stories or reading or writing or drawing, something that was about imagination, mm-hmm. I was always into that. I'd have loved to have been a writer, but drawing a picture is a quicker way to get to that, for me anyway, than trying to figure out a little backstory. So you can just go, oh, this is exactly what he is, and you should be able to figure everything out by the way I've drawn it. So yeah, I think that was, it was sort of mid to late teens when I really figured out that drawing was a thing that I did, not a thing that everybody does.
Okay. And were your family supportive of that? Were like, yeah, you can't be drawing goblins for money. That's clearly not a viable career choice. Or
I don't think that it ever entered into it. You know, there's four of us, so you do whatever you want. Just get out of the house. So we, like me and my brothers and sisters, I've got a very eclectic range of careers. So I'm the youngest of four. The oldest is a police officer. Mm-hmm. Next oldest is a chiropractor. Brother above me teaches English in Japan, and I draw pictures of goblins. So it's just, and my mum was a scientist. A microbiologist, to be specific. If you want to go into that, we can do. But so it was that was a really great thing to have, is no one ever told me to stop doing anything. It was just do something, don't sit down and do nothing. Mm-hmm. I never got pushed into any environment I didn't want to go in. Sounds a bit creepy now, I said that.
And how did this take you to Games Workshop and the design studio? When did you first become aware of an opening there, an opportunity?
A million years ago, my brother, I keep going on about him now, he's going to get a bigger ego than he's already got.
Your brother, who's been featured in White Dwarf magazine.
Well, he entered a competition in White Dwarf and won one of the big four drilled Abadons that we did at the time. And some tickets to an open day at Warhammer World. So we came down to that, and there was a seminar by whoever was the art manager at the time, who was talking about all sorts of things, and I was like, oh, that man works with the people that do the thing that I like. Well, I can ask him. So I did, and then that never went anywhere. I think he lost my email. But I think then that then now cemented itself in my head that, no, this is actually a place, and it's not just like a fun thing that other people have done. You can actually do this. As soon as you see that somebody else has got that position, signifies itself as a way in. And then I just carried on pursuing it. I managed to, just by chance, meet an old sculptor that used to work here through other means, and he invited me down to visit the studio. So, you know, when I was a little girl, I used to come and visit Paul and Alex, and look at your drawings, look at mine. And it was great fun, and I keep reminding them how old young I was and how old they now are.
Mm. It'll happen to you.
But it was so inspirational then to see that studio and all those like normal people doing this as their actual job. Mm. And there was no one telling them they should have gone elsewhere and gone to uni or doing things, and they probably did, and the ones that didn't enjoy it. There we go. And then from then I just I really hit it. Then I went from being, you know, the guy who really doesn't like being at school, really doesn't like doing all these things that people tell him what to do, and going, I just want to draw all the time, constantly, and paint everything. And I became like a massive art nerd, and I still am.
So, how did your art nerdism manifest? What were your favourite mediums to work in, and what did you need to get better at or do more of to make it as a professional?
I think I at that point, because sixth form time, so late teens, I'd figured out that this career or life choice that I wanted to do didn't really have a lot to do with, or entirely to do with, the way that I was being taught. Mm-hmm. at the time. So I was doing an A-level course in art and a few other subjects at the time. And then this thing hit. So I thought, well, I can change what I do to really focus on that, which meant my grades took a massive, massive shock. For anyone worried about education, I got a D in A-level art and I'm now a professional illustrator, so haha.
Yeah.
I quit half of my A-level course and went and did a sitting guild in ceramics at local art college because they were running life drawing sessions. Mm-hmm. I was like, oh, I want to be able to draw the figure. Mm-hmm. I can go and do this there. And all of a sudden, it was just a new set of people who, rather than trying to push me into doing things I didn't really want to do to get a qualification out of it, they went, this guy wants to draw. Come here and draw. This guy wants to throw pots. Mm-hmm. Come and throw pots. I love doing that. Mm-hmm. I think I'm a failed ceramicist. They're struggling his way through as a fantasy sci-fi illustrator. And being in that environment for the first time and realizing that like this was an incorrigible thing to do, is to draw and to paint, was not just a silly thing you do outside your other studies. It is a really professional, serious vocation. And once I was able to spot that, I could then really, really stride onto it. And, you know, went to every single life drawing class that was going, tried every medium that I was going, attempted every picture that I could do. And sometimes you look back and think, my approach to my work then was, let's give it a go.
Yep.
Whereas now you're in a job, your approach to it is like, this really better be good. And this next one better be good. This next one better be good. Whereas now, you know, I get really hung up on the quality of my work and whether it stands up with what the other people in the team are doing, and whether it stands up with what like the legacy of Games Workshop's art is doing. You still got to try and keep that original idea of, you love what you do. So and that's where the real quality comes from, is the excitement that you have for your own work.
I was going to ask, how did you identify the things that you needed to know to be the sort of artist that you've become if you weren't going to follow a formalised teaching way? But it sounds like you just give everything a go and take on board the things that are useful and you want to make use of again.
Yeah, it's an odd one, because I think what makes Games Workshop's art so good, I'm not trying to include my mediocre daubings in that, but the legacy of work that this company has created, and that's the way that I treat my position within the team. It's not, now it's my turn. It's more, what can I add to this whole thing? Mm-hmm. And it's an evolving, constantly shaping thing. And where can I fit my work in there? What things can I build on? What things can I reinforce? What things can I learn from? Mm-hmm. And a lot of that is understanding the ideas and the influences that led to the 40K and Warhammer settings, and figure out where they came from. So I did, I've always been into history. Yeah. And just like life and whatever. I grew up in the countryside, spent most of my time outdoors, and so the big influences of an understanding of the real world and how things affect the real world and how history and legacy and like the almost damaging weight of history can affect modern day life. Mm-hmm. Is a huge thing, especially in 40K at the moment. Is how do you tell people that 40K is not just science fiction, as in it's a fictional futuristic place where anything can happen? It's kind of the opposite. It's a fictional futuristic place where not a lot can happen because of the huge damaging weight of humanity. Mm. And you know, the struggles that brings with it. And by understanding the history of our world and the history of different cultures, that makes you able to reinterpret things that we've frankly made up.
Yep.
So I through that approach, I've always felt that it wasn't that much of a leap to understand what we're trying to do as a team. I'm not sure if that's what you asked me, but
I can't remember what I asked you, but it was a good answer. Yeah. Either way, I liked it. I guess there's a lot of parallels, I guess, with life drawing. If you're going to draw fantastical stuff, you need to know how the real stuff works to be able to know what to exaggerate and what to deform.
Yeah, you have to, well, in in the way that I approach what I do, and the way a lot of the other people on the team approach what they do, and in the wider industry, you have to accept that it's art and it's a craft. The arts and crafts thing has become a bit silly. That's a word we give to sort of, you know, paintings of cats on cushions and things like that. If it's a good painting of a cat on a cushion, it's fine.
Nothing wrong with
but it is. It's you've got to put as much time into understanding your subject as you would in any other thing. So one of the first gigs I did for workshop a million years ago was when we were still doing historical rule sets.
Yep.
And I did, I think one of the first ones was a book on Battle of Waterloo, and I knew nothing about the Battle of Waterloo. It was all sort of tedious men in red jackets, and I went around and read books after books. I did all the studies. I tried to figure out what the, you know, Hougoumont farm looked like so I could draw it, and I realised that I've been doing as much research as somebody who's doing a degree course on this thing, trying to figure out everything that works, because it has to be right, because it's a real thing. And I think that going through projects like that and others gave me that understanding of how much work needs to go into getting it right. And so in order to do really good figurative artwork, in order to invent and be and innovate and create, you have to have an understanding to a certain degree of how reality works, and then you can break it. Because if you try and invent without a basis on something that the layperson can understand, that person who is the final result of your piece isn't going to understand it, because they've got nothing to relate it to. So really good creature design, for example, sits in a way that the person looking at the figure, watching the film, playing the game or whatever, they can relate to it and see how far you stretched. Whereas sometimes if you stretch too far, then that becomes like,
what is it?
I don't get it. It's and that in itself is a good design. If that's what you want to do, if you want to create something which is so outrageous that people aren't really going to be able to relate to it, you know, the 2001 sort of stuff, and that's the purpose of that design. Whereas a lot of our stuff has to be grounded to a degree that people can latch onto it, in my opinion.
That's a fine opinion. The learned opinion. So do you remember what the first 40K pieces of artwork you worked on in the studio were?
I think that actually the first 40K piece I did was a map.
Was it?
It was a map.
Map
I think
what?
I worked with you in it at
was
the time.
It was Crusade, one of those books.
No, it was a Tau thing.
Oh yeah, Wars of Damocles.
Yes, yeah, and it had sort of canyons in it, whatever. Yeah. And it was quite, it was funny to look back on at the time, because, you know, I've been working really hard to be this figurative illustrator, and one of the first gigs I got was draw this map. But I'm not a cartographer, I'm not a graphic designer, and it was always do all these things with arrows and boxes, and I was really out of my depth, so I drew it.
Yeah.
Like I was flying through space looking at the floor, and I drew like a realist depiction of a world, thinking like, oh, I really mucked this up because I don't really know what I'm doing. And then people went, oh, that's quite interesting. Yeah. I didn't think you'd do that. And then I think the stuff I did after that was the Black Crusade stuff with lots of Red Marines fighting other Red
Black
Marines.
Red and Black Marines, It's interesting because there's quite a few folk in the art departments in the studio who will have tried their hands at maps. We don't really have a dedicated cartographer. I think John Mickelmack was the kind of astro cartographer for a long time because he did a lot of galaxy maps for 40K.
Yeah.
But various people I'm aware of have worked on maps. And
we try to do that deliberately, because what we don't want to do is pigeonhole people into certain things and then sort of stifle what they can do, and also stop other people from bringing a new idea into whatever. So we cycle everything around. So we're always trying to all work on graphics, figurative illustration, and everything that falls in between. Certain people have certain strengths. Certain things you'll go, you really want Alex to do that, or you really want John to do this. But ideally, you want to have a go at everything. And it keeps you fresh as well.
Yeah.
It gives you enough time to really want to go back to the other thing.
Is there anything that you hate and you do intentionally badly so that no one asks you to do it again?
The washing up.
in art, not in art.
No, good. I don't think so. I think in my interview for the job, one of the things it asked, it was a bit like a give me a question at the end, is what would be the thing you most want to work on, and then what would the thing you least want to work on. And because a lot of my influences in my approach to drawing and painting come from organic reference. I love drawing trees and animals and all sorts of things, and drawing from nature, go outside the sketchbook, figuring things out, figuring how things move and shape and all these sorts of things. So I said, doing something like Necrons against Tau with all those straight lines, I couldn't bear the idea of that. But since then, I've had occasion to do those sorts of images and actually really enjoyed it, because rather than going, I have to change my approach, I go, no, I'm not going to change my approach. How can I use my skill set, the thing that I try to be good at, to tackle these different challenging subject matters? And it works, because you then have a different eye. Like with a map thing, you have a different eye than the other dude had, and can be quite cool sometimes. Says me. A lot of people might thought it was rubbish, but there we go.
So how did you get your inspiration or your influences for the Necrons or Tau, other races that you can't find analogues for out in the natural world as easily?
I think my approach to doing illustration stuff, I think a lot of it comes from the schedule that we have. When I was drawing at college and whatever, it was, spend your first few weeks gathering your resources and learning about things, whereas now you finish a painting on a Friday, or usually on a Monday morning, or a Sunday night, and you start a new one on the Monday. Or there's a lot of overlap, so there's no real time for that. Let's sit around and read some stuff. You just have to attack it. And the more that happens, the more a natural or a more intuitive approach to working with new subject matter comes across. Or comes up rather, because you just sometimes the initial reaction you have to something is the reaction you want the person looking at your artwork to have.
Yep.
And then you use the information that you've learned over years and years and years of doing this job and keeping your eyes open when you're walking around and being a student of lots of different things, not to sound too pretentious, but and then you just attack whatever you're doing with that on the Monday morning. And then you try and get to about sort of Wednesday, Thursday afternoon where you can coast and then panic massively on a Friday.
And I guess you're going to know it's coming. Like you're going to have to engage with that at some point, even if your background and what you used to might be more natural. If you're going to work on the 41st millennium, you're going to have to cover all of those textures at some point. So
yeah, definitely. And that alludes to some of the different parts of our day-to-day job is sometimes one half of your painting will be about, I don't know, orcs or space marines, and you kind of know what they are. You've grown up in these things. You've got a natural understanding of how they work. In your head is your own internal monologue of what these things look like, how they react, how they feel. Mm-hmm. And then the miniatures team will kindly deliver a plastic tray full of brand new things and go, I'll do some paintings of those. And you think, well, I don't know what they are.
How does that move?
But good artwork, in terms of what we do in the studio, should have a really good understanding of what the purpose of these things is, and so that when the player has the character piece, the artwork should be giving them a lot more flavour about what's behind that character piece. So when that comes up to us and we don't know what's behind it, we've got to read through all the information and speak to the designers, and that's a huge part of where I get my ideas from is I know loads of the designers and I ask them, and it's a really good thing to do. And you not only do you get to know what they thought behind that individual thing, you get to know what they think about the way that they design.
Yeah,
because everyone's different. Everyone has their own approach to certain things, within the art team, within the writers, within the miniatures team, and even the figure painters. Not even the figure painters, as well as the figure painters. Yeah, and you can pick up on the sort of different design languages and creative points that various people trigger off.
Yeah.
So I know Jez very well. So when Jez designs a figure, I kind of know what he's thinking about because we've had these conversations and we've been to those art galleries and we've been around those museums. We don't hold hands or anything like that, but we might have a few drinks afterwards. So I sort of get what he's aiming at, and vice versa, I think. So, and that's nice as well because you can find out what he's working on because he'll tell you, and then go, oh, that's cool. I've got an idea for that, and then he can riff off this and that maybe. So what we're doing a lot more recently is actually the good side of what's happening at the moment is a lot of the artwork is being done at the same time as the figures. So the figures we sort of 80% complete and we'll start working on them, which can mean, fingers crossed, they don't change their minds because otherwise we've done half of the artwork. But it also can mean that the miniatures guys are seeing some of the artwork so they can see what we've done to interpret their ideas. And then maybe there's some crossover, maybe there's some feedback to be got from it as well. We'd like to think maybe they laugh at it. I don't know.
I guess a lot of the artwork you'll be doing as well, you're not just drawing the miniatures, you'll be drawing the environments they live in, and you might be drawing machinery or war gear.
The actual figure itself is secondary to the purpose of what the illustration is, because we're there to put it into context. So we have to look at the new figure or the old figures and figure out how their environment looks based on how they look. Maybe it's the same, maybe it's the opposite. Maybe what we need to do is put them in a harsh environment to make them look strong because they're battling against it, or vice versa, put them in, you know. So context and tone and all these things are the most important thing. And that's a catch-all, well, tone especially, is a catch-all thing for narrative, for context. And that's what makes 40K 40K. Yes, it is skulls and spikes and strappy chainsaws, which are the most important thing. But the tone with which we approach what we do makes it different from other people's settings.
So you've just mentioned the tone of Warhammer 40,000. I'd be interested to hear how you describe 40K to, let's call them normals, people who don't work already for the Games Workshop studio or are not really connected with the hobby. How do you explain what 40K is to people?
This is a sort of, it's an idea or a way of coming at it that I've only really started to think of in the last year or so, especially when we've had new artists joining the team or freelancers working for us, or the rate at which we're now dealing with new content, new ranges or whatever, is when you start working at Games Workshop, especially in the creative sides that deal with IP generation and things like that, you realise, oh, there's actually a lot of different ideas, and everyone has their idea of what our settings are, and then together we work on that and put that idea forward as a whole. And so how do we explain the difference between a hero and a hero of the Imperium? Because they're not necessarily the same thing in principle. Because there's good guys and there's bad guys, and then there's 40K, where there's just a lot of guys in there. But
there's a spectrum of nasty people.
Yeah, and it's not you're not on the good side or on the bad side. This is just your side, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Like, you know, it would probably, and that's one of, you know, some of the big gags, for lack of a better word, in our IP, is the sort of subversive bits, which, if you think about it, what the Emperor needs to do is just sort of like give it up, and if only humanity could just like shuffle off, then better things could solve all those problems. But humanity's our side, and so we're not doing that. And that's what gives you really interesting narrative themes to play with, because, and again, through that thing of studying a lot of history, is, I imagine, I'm putting a very sweeping statement, but So look at our predicaments, if we have them at the moment in the world, with the climate and population and politics and all sorts of things. We always think that there's a hope and a way out, because there is. It's going to get better, Wade. It's going to be all right. Be all right. But in the Imperium, in 40K, the way I treat it is they're well aware that they are in the middle of a millennia-long struggle, and it ain't going to end for them anytime soon or ever. And that is a completely different take on the psyche of how people live and how they react to their environments. And when I say live, I don't mean how they farm their bread and where, you know, where they take their dog for a walk and things like that. It's how they sit within the context of the environment that we've created, within the context of the narrative that we've created, and that explains to me how to draw them in my pictures. And that hero thing again, it's, you know, in our setting, no longer is the hero gonna win the day and get the girl or guy and get a medal and fly off in a spaceship. There's no closing credits. There's no theme tune. They just have to survive and do bad things to make that happen, and give up a lot of their selves in order to carry the IP on. Mm-hmm. And that what that does in terms of a game playing thing, it doesn't give any absolute endpoints. So you can come in at any level you want and play your army, and you can have your heroes or your villains if you want to. Ultimately knowing in the back of your head that it isn't really going to affect anything. And that's quite fun, because it means you can do anything you want. Yeah. You do anything you want in our setting and get away with it. You know, there's the galactic so-and-so isn't going to come and tell you off and put you in jail because they'll probably try and shoot you, but you know, you can fire back.
And we might never hear about it anyway, because yeah, the galaxy is a big place. So
exactly.
Just get lost.
And that allows for a lot of satire, not mm-hmm. not comedy satire, but a lot of how do you deal with this range of human experience and emotion and things like that. And we can do that in a way that is sometimes quite brutal and quite severe and bleak. Mm. And it's not because we're brutal and severe and bleak people. Sometimes a bit bleak, but you know, Friday comes around and Bugman's even just the way. We're all right. So there are fun things you can do with the heroes in our game. And I keep talking about heroes, I'm not that interested in them, but
a given value of heroism.
Yeah, like. Yeah. And it's that thing when I mentioned John's They Shall Know No Fear picture of seeing, as a kid, opening that up and going, is this the hero of the game? This guy, this grizzled old man in a big robot suit who looks really angry. You know, he's not going to like take you under his wing or whatever, and he'll crush you with his big metal hand. And that's quite fun, because for me personally, the idea of the good-looking chiseled jaw thing, the idea of good-looking people in general, like,
it's disgusting, isn't it?
It does. It winds me up.
Conventionally attractive, you know, people.
So I sit there in the movie theaters watching this, going, I can't relate with that guy. I cannot relate with him. Like, oh, and look, you know, and then they do the transformation of sort of nerd into superhero, like shuffling around the school corridor, his backpack with his gorgeous good looks and his really hot friend. You know, like, this is a lie. It's an absolute lie. Whereas there's a lot of truths in what we do. I know that's a bit stupid thing to say, but it's the fact that, you know, the person who actually solves the problem or comes to the rescue isn't that guy. It isn't the good-looking guy with the haircut. It's a potato-faced space marine who has sacrificed his humanity in order to save humanity. And that's the big, like, the tragic joke of marines is that they are the saviours of humanity, but they are now no longer human. They've taken themselves out of that thing. They are looked upon as monsters by everybody else. So I try not to do in my depictions of those scenes the hooray, it's the space marine and like on all the nice imperial guards, and go woo. It's more like, oh my word, what is that? Yeah. That scary man. He goes, oh, I didn't realise that you were people. Like, I was just told to defend humanity, you snivelling idiots. Like, get out of my way, I'm trying to shoot this alien. So there's all those quite fun things to play on, and it's a lot of it does come out of
that sort of odd way of looking at comedy. If you think of a lot of like good British comedy, a lot of it is very bleak. It's that thing of you're not laughing with the character, you're laughing at them.
And you're glad it's not happening to you.
The hero is the fool. Yeah. The hero is the tragedy, is the comic tragedy. Look at me, I'm trying to say it's like Shakespeare.
Well, Shakespearean. But there was definitely an ambition, I think, with the 8th edition 40k book, that as a conventional human of the third millennium terror, you'd open that book and you'd see the two extreme outcomes as presented by the Imperium of Man or by the Worshippers of the Gods of Chaos, and you should look at that and go, No, I don't want to live in either of those futures. That's horrible. Why have you presented these as two choices? And then you look at the Horus Heresy novels, and you go, oh, that's what it is. That's even more heartbreaking. You get that tragedy writ large.
Well, that's
across
the idea.
Like,
it could be worse. In the Grim Knights of the Future, it could be worse.
It could always get worse.
Stop complaining.
And so, like, the Space Marines saving humanity, it's just keeping their heads above water.
Well, that's
like,
it's only just managing. And that's the thing of the person knowing that they're in the middle of this big expanse, which is an odd thing to play on. And Jez refers to it a lot with the skull of the Emperor, anyone's interpretation of that can be. I keep saying interpretation. I'm not sure if that's a word. Is it interpretation or
interpretation
of why we use that imagery can be different for a lot of people. But for me and some of the other artists as well, it's not something you tend to talk about, you just tend to know it, is that sort of death cult mentality of the thing. Humanity is in mourning for the death of its species whilst it's still alive all the time, because it's essentially over. All they can do now is survive, because humanity is the same as the Emperor. It's in stasis. It's only surviving. That's all it's doing. It's not going to win, and eventually, they might think that, and we might set up with, but eventually they're not going to beat chaos. They're not going to overcome all the orcs. They're going to get rid of this, and then, it's like trying to fix your house. You pluck that up, and then that will start leaking, and the boiler will go. And which is quite fun, because you can play with that idea that we're stuck in time, and then that feeds over into why didn't they just invent like different sorts of warp travel, and they've had so long to do that, why don't they just invent this and solve all these problems? It's because they can't. They don't know it anymore, because with all the things of the AI stuff that happened at the start of the narrative, and we're seeing a bit of that now. Again, it's a satire thing. We've given ourselves so much over to technology now that I don't know how to fix the leaks in my house. I have to get a man in and I have to figure it out, and he charges me loads of money and I'm like, well, I don't get it. And then our approach to that is you accelerate that, you wind it up to the nth degree, and you have a people that have given all of their information over to a third party, who they've then gone to war with, somehow managed to defeat, but now they don't know anything. Like, they don't know anything. So it's not a case of, oh, they'll just invent a new laser weapon. They don't understand how electricity works. For innovation in a hive planet, you'd have to have your Einsteins and your Newtons and your whoever else turning up, and they ain't going to happen when you're getting attacked by mutant rats or whatever. So that allows us to stick in a very medieval way of dealing with our science fiction. And there is that thing of it isn't science fiction, it's science fantasy. What does that mean? Well, there isn't faster than light. Well, there probably is, but there isn't all these things, phasers and all that gizmos. There's wizards and goblins and demons, like actual demons. Every time we do something about, what do these people in this agri world do? And you go, there's actual demons. like, always bear that in mind. Every time we do anything, go, but there is like actual aliens in that space that aren't going to come and sign up new trade deals with you. They're going to kill you. They're going to do it.
They might not probe your cattle. Just forcibly invade your planet.
Exactly. And the interesting thing about what we have done is we've set up this completely bonkers, over-the-top environment. Everything is out there to get us. But what's the most terrifying thing in our setting? Well, it's probably a lot of the things in the Imperium. You know, the the Space Marines, the assassins, my favourite, the assassins, I love them, especially the Cluxus. He's a nightmare. He's an actual nightmare who's going to hunt you down in your dreams and then murder you. And you won't realise that he's just a guy with a weird hat on. You will think it is your night, whatever you're most afraid of, he is that. And he's going to come and get you. Mm. And that thing of man as monster is... That's the thing that I try and get over when I'm dealing with the human side of our IP, mm-hmm. Because then that means when I go and do an orc, I've got to really level it up, because you can't go, an orc's the funny ones with cars. They're monsters, actual like monsters. So chaos is no interest to them, because mm-hmm. they're monsters, and they're going to get you. So yeah, the more you have to leave room within each interpretation of each race to let the other ones exist.
Yep.
So you can't do everything with one setting, everything with one character, because you'll run out of ideas and you can't have that yin and yang against certain things. But it is fun to see how far we can push one thing to the other side. Mm. So when I draw my Marines, I want them to look worse than Chaos Marines, so that when I get around to doing a Chaos Marine, he's not just a man with gold arrows stuck over him. He's an actual... evil, demonic, barbarian in space. Yeah, because that's fun, isn't it? Yeah,
that's what we want. Yeah. So the Shadow Sphere box cover—that was one of yours, wasn't it? So that's got Space Marines and Chaos Space Marines represented.
Yeah, yeah.
I feel like we should acknowledge some of your art, because otherwise people might just think,
"Oh, yeah, I'm making it all
up." In a man who has
middle manager who does nothing. I'm pontificated across the table.
Well, when I contacted you about this, first of all, your initial response was, "Well, most of the things that people will know will have been from your early career, and maybe you would be less enthusiastic about talking about some of the other things." Yeah. So we've been talking in quite
my first few albums.
Difficult second album. We've been talking quite broadly, I think, about the principles of 40K and artwork in the studio, and that's grand. But we can definitely name check the Shadow Spear piece, because it's right behind you, and it's got a couple of the things in that.
Yeah. So what we can do there is talk about actually some of the different roles in the studio.
Yeah.
So. As an art team, we do absolutely everything of the visual stuff that goes into a book, and then the book designers will also do some graphic-y stuff, quite a lot of graphic stuff a lot of times, but mostly anything that looks like it's involved some sort of scribbling, we've done it. So that goes from all the internal illustrations to the graphic borders and the spot illustrations and all bits and bobs, right the way up to cover art and box art. So the difference in the way that we approach a piece of box art to the way that we approach a double page spread scene, battle scene within the book is a distinct difference. There's the same overall approach, but in internal artwork, we can do quite a lot to overlay much more context and narrative and tone, because you've already got your army. And you've got your rules, and this is to make you go, wow, wouldn't it be great if, and when, you know, when you go to bed and they're in the cupboard, this is what they're doing, they're running around and fighting, because that's what actually happens, we all know this. Whereas box art is to do all of those things, but it's also front and centre POS material, and it has to be, these are the figures in the box, and this is the way that they work. Mm-hmm. So the Shadow Spear cover was... probably like the third, maybe, battle box set that I've done.
Yep.
So it's normally like two forces against each other. Sort of things like the Blight War and the Tooth and Claw one and Death Mask ages ago. Yeah. And I think there's a lineage between the Death Mask, which would be like two people going, meh,
yep.
and then slowly growing up into my approach to the Shadow Spear was, because this time there was three leading role characters on the Marine side versus... definitely one, maybe two or three on the Chaos side. You've got the horny guy with the book and the things. We never know. It's same as the miniature guys. We never know any of the names of it because we finish the work before the names. So there's the blue dudes with the stabby thing and the cloak, and then there's the fiery guys. So what I couldn't do, what I didn't want to do was go, oh, there's the captain versus the sorcerer, and then you might see the other guy in the background. I wanted to go, let's try and go further with this within the time frame I've got to produce the work and do something that's more energetic, which says a lot about what these figures are supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
because yes, there's hints in the design of them towards a more stealth aspect of them, but I see the stealth aspect is them getting to the arena of combat, and then they're not going to sneak up on you. They're going spitting and cursing or whatever. So that's what I'm trying to do with the. I'm conscious I'm talking about something which is like over my shoulder, but it's right there.
Otherwise, sort of behind you. It's literally behind
you.
Oh,
is it? Oh, there you go. No one can see it. Never mind.
We'll flash it up on the screen as you're talking about it.
Yeah, so you know, there is that. You know, there is characters physically interacting with each other. Really short range impact motion mm-hmm. going on, and then hopefully, if I've done it right, a bit of tension between the two main protagonists. The big goodie and the big baddie.
Yeah.
So that picture should really be where your game ends every time you play the game, because in 30 seconds, if not less, they're all dead. and in doing a piece like that, because you don't know who's going to be picking that box up. Is it the Chaos player? Is it the Marine player? Is it somebody brand new who wants to give it a go? So you want to be able to allow them to carry on that story in their head to the conclusion that they want. So they might pick that up and go, those Marines are done for because there's a big mutant monster guy there and he's clearly got a big fireball thing going on, haha. Or you might think those Chaos guys are done for because bang, 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 bang. And, yeah, and if when you draw, you do the sound effects as well. It really does help.
Yeah.
It really does help. So we have to have our headphones on quite loud, otherwise you can just, you know,
just hear Alex going. Who do you think's going to win?
I just think it's going to be carnage. Yeah. It's going to be absolute carnage.
Like I say, it'll be over in 30
and
seconds.
You know, I'm going back to that belief thing. I don't think it matters who's going to win, because they've tried so hard to get to this place and solve all these problems, and like, it doesn't matter.
Yeah, we're going to die.
Because there's a Tunid fleet going across the sky. And there's some orcs going. They're all going to die.
Yeah.
And because that used to be approach of some of the old Warhammer narrative, and I tend to see that as well with the 40k stuff through. The research did in history things is that it happens in the past. If you treat it as if it's it doesn't really matter what's going on, it matters to them, but in a kind of really dour way that like, yeah, but they're all dead, and you can go in and you can try and do what you want within that sphere of war to fight your guys out of it, but it, you know, even if you succeed, you know, several planet systems away, there's something else happening which you've got no influence over. And tough.
So see how long you can survive before you die.
Well, yeah, exactly. Yeah, but if you don't do that, everything will be destroyed. So you have to do that, or it's just a game. Just a joke. Take that seriously.
It's got massive galactic implications. I think you've made those pretty clear, and that's good.
Yeah. So the same when we do a cover art for books as well. That's got to say at the moment our direction for those pieces is to use a single character more or less to say a lot about the range, and then again that's about the tone. You could just get away with drawing one of the figures from the range, but what we try and do is sum up the whole narrative and tone within this character, which is what the figures should be doing anyway. They should be saying, a Space Marine should say things about Space Marines, an Orc should say things about Orcs, and Eldar, I suppose.
So we talked a bit about some of the different sorts of artwork that's performed by the illustrators in the studio.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to talk about the prospect or the opportunities for people to come and do that as a career, because I guess I was a bit glib about how maybe your family might have supported or not supported the notion of drawing for money, for a living, and it's worked out very well, kudos. But 20 years ago, 30 years ago, it feels like there were far fewer opportunities to realistically think, I'm going to draw dragons for money. And now Games Workshop's definitely got loads of opportunities, but there's other media out there. There's games and apps and all sorts of things. So if people want to be a Games Workshop illustrator or work illustrator for the Warhammer Studios,
what you're alluding to is right. It's on the one hand, it's never been a better time. If you like doing drawy, painty, designy stuff, there are infinite possibilities for you to go and do whatever you want to do. And that's always my advice to anyone who comes to one of our open days, or if we go to industry events, is first and foremost, do what you want to do and allow the opportunity of where that work is going to take you to turn up. Don't worry about the cash. You can make money doing all sorts of stuff one of my favourite jobs was picking up horse muck in a field. Once I loved that, wheeling my wheelbarrow over humpity back hills. It was just brilliant. Do that forever. But unfortunately, I had to settle for being a science fiction fantasy artist. So do the thing that you like. So it's great that there are loads of courses at the moment teaching concept art or animation or graphic design or whatever. But keep what you love doing at the core of what you do. Because if you end up in 10 years' time working in animation when you wanted to be a concept artist, or working as an illustrator when you wanted to sculpt, you'll have to make a decision join then to go, this isn't what I wanted to do, or isn't close enough to what I wanted to do. And God knows you put enough of yourself into sorting these things out that if you don't get to where you want to do, that's really annoying. So I'm lucky. This is the job that I wanted when I was a kid. The actual physical seat in the studio, I wanted that and I got it. It took a hell of a lot of hard time and hard work, long time and hard work rather. So I sympathise with people who haven't got that cemented, largely because, as you said, that there's so much more opportunity out there. So keep working. Don't narrow too early. And then be very honest about what it is you want to do. If you really like painting pictures of monsters, maybe you don't want to be a monsters designer. Maybe you want to be an illustrator, because there's a lot of design that you can do as an illustrator. Yes, you'll be working on largely someone else's idea. So here, when I illustrate a piece, it's based on the designs that the figure designers have done, which is based largely on what the concept artists or the lead designers have done. But then within that, there is all the design of how I choose to interpret that thing, the context that I put it in, the environment, and then all the supporting staff that I when I draw a space marine, every time I see a plastic space marine on a table, there are 10 or so other guys carrying his stuff. Mm. There's the lunch servitor, there's the bedtime night hat servitor, and all these ones that go with them.
Serfs with swords. And,
well, exactly, yeah. Yeah. And those are the things that I have loads of fun designing, and those are my ideas that I can put into the thing, and that's brilliant. So don't think that you will get pigeonholed into doing that. Also, if you want to be a concept artist, don't think that you'll get stuck never being able to illustrate something, because every now and again, I've been spoken to the one of the concept artists, Dave Ferry, over the weekend. Every now and again, they get asked just to go a bit further with something, and go, you know, we're doing loads of figure concepts, for example, and they might go, can you do something environmental, just so we can give this to the figure designers, so they've got a bit of context to work on. You want to know who that guy is, maybe where he's from, maybe what his environment looks like. Is it an oppressive one? Is it an open one? Because that will feed into the way that that character looks. You know, you might change the posture of something because you know where he lives. You know, if he lives in a cramped space station, then you're not going to have him lording around, unless that's what you want. So specialising shouldn't stifle what you want to do. So keep that in mind. In terms of specifically for the illustration position, if you want to come and work for us, The way in which we hire and look for artists changes massively all the time, because the business changes, the size of the studio changes, the projects we're working on change. If an artist is leaving or joining, there might be a particular set of abilities that we're looking for to get through in someone else. So just keep your eye open. We do use some freelance artists. Mm-hmm. If you're good, there's every chance we'll use you, because that's what we're into, is people who can draw and paint well, and that is a specific thing. If you can draw and paint well, specifically draw well, you will be a good artist. You will get work and you will enjoy what you do. A fundamental understanding of the natural world, the way you depict that on paper. How to manipulate shape and form, how to make marks, how to interpret an idea, how to put your own idea down. All of these things come from work. You don't become the best 100 meter runner in the world just by running the 100 meters over and over again. You don't become the best dragon painter in the world just by doing I just draw loads of dragons. But what do you know about other animals? What's the difference between your dragon and the next guy's one? Well, the next guy has spent loads of time studying. He spent loads of time working on his form. He understands how to use the scale, pun scale, but the way in which you draw something. Are you drawing it from straight on, from up or down? Which lighting are you using to inform the person that's looking at it to make it look better or work? You know, make it look worse, either, but to try and make it look better. So understanding all these things will make you better, and it will be the things that we look for as a studio.
I'd like to give a little mention to your Howling Griffin's apothecary piece that was in the 40k rulebook, because I think that when I imagine that's got the kind of apothecary's assistance. Was Imperial Fists? Yeah,
yellow
ones. Corrected. Yellow. Yeah, I was imagining the yellow and the red.
They could have been red the other side, but they were facing side on, weren't they?
That's got the kind of apothecary's assistant. There's like the non space marine
attendance
figures.
Yeah.
That's the kind of like the invisible attendant.
Well, exactly.
Stuff.
So and that comes to the design element of it. I can then riff off that idea, and it's quite an old piece now, so it's a bit hokey. But
this is it. This is the stuff that you wouldn't want to talk about,
exactly. The brief of that piece was, I think it was like Space Marines Victorious was the idea, and originally the brief was to have some Marines come walking out of the mist looking tough. And that goes to the thing we said at the very start about what's the difference between a 40k hero and a generic sci-fi or fantasy hero. In ours, the hero is in this picture is actually quite bleak. The hero is the guy that's dying on the floor. He's the one that's given his life for the protection of what appears to be desolation all around him. So they might have defeated the enemy, but the only way they manage to do that is by destroying everything. And that's quite awful. But there is also, there's that means you're reaching up and touching, because they're all brothers in the Marines thing. It's the actual biological brothers. So the death of one of their comrades is quite a significant thing. But only one of them is paying attention, because the others are all looking out, and you know, there's a guy throwing the thing off the back, which people on the internet think is funny.
Go be chaos over there.
So it's to get that emotional thing. I don't mean emotional as in sort of handkerchiefs and things like that, but it's that emotional impact of going, what's going on in this picture? It seems really bizarre. Like, yeah, there's something going on there after the battle, before the battle, during or whatever. So then like you say, there's the design bit which I was able to put in by those extra dudes, and if you can lay on enough illustrations of the actual content there, that gives you free rein to do your little bits. So it's a give and take. If you can give a lot of stuff, you're allowed to do, not in terms of allowed as in what we are or not allowed to do, but in terms of an illustration. If I was to just do a painting of loads of those weird guys, it wouldn't make much sense. Or you'd go, why have you changed the idea of what a space marine is? But by doing some very straight interpretations of the figures, it then allows me to riff off some more odd things.
Yeah,
and those designs aren't designs where I've sat down and written, you know, what will this guy do? What is his purpose? That comes from all the life drawing, the figure study, where you just start drawing and you design through drawing. An ability to draw, to make marks on paper or digital in this case, it is an element of design in itself. If you can understand how to intuitively move through a shape, and that's how I tend to start with all my illustrations, really, is I might have an idea of narrative when I begin, but it's literally going, I've got this rectangle, today I'm working on a long rectangle shaped picture, and I want it to look a bit leery in terms of motion and broody, so I'll probably put this shape there, then that shape there, and there'll be a squiggle there and a dot there because I put that squiggle there, and then eventually the image starts to morph into something, and then something will snag onto an idea here, and then I go, oh, okay, so I've got that there, so I'm going to put this there, and then this there, and then that there. So it moves along. So that's the way you design a composition, and it's also the way you design a character. You just start going. Sometimes you'll have a strong idea, or the brief will be to, you know, draw Bob with his bag of shopping, and you do that. Often it is intuitive, but it's not intuitive as if it's some sort of like creative genius, because it isn't. It's I've done so much of this stuff. I've done so much drawing of the figure. When we do the life drawing sessions that I run here, we'll, as well as having models come in and pose for artists and sculptors and anyone else wants to come, I will do things like specifically say, today we're going to be focusing on how different costumes, just a different set of jackets that the model owns, will change the way that he stands, will change the body shape, will change the gesture. And so what you don't do is like, Phil sat here like this in his t-shirt, or Phil sat here like this in his coat in the same pose, Phil sat here like this in his sombrero and his poncho in the same pose, because all those things change your body shape, change your gesture, change your attitude. That's what fashion design is all about, how to make someone look taller, shorter, more refined, more clumsy, or whatever. And understanding how those shapes and approaches to design can manipulate the tone and the narrative and the emotional impact of the work you're doing makes you a better artist, because it gives you something more than somebody who can just draw a crushed Coke can on a tabletop in really fine detail pencil. I mean, that's a great skill, but it's not going to make you a good Games Workshop illustrator or concept artist or anything. But, you know, draw those Coke cans, because it's still life, and that's a skill.
Yep.
You've got to learn to do all those things.
But if Games Workshop needs a photorealistic representation of a Citadel miniature, it's probably going to be a photograph, first and foremost.
Well,
artist impression.
Yeah, and that's the thing, actually. It's a good point. And when we work with the photography guys here, a lot of that is understanding whose job is which job.
Yeah.
Because there is a lot of overlap. They can do photography, which starts to look like illustration. We can do illustration that starts to look like photography. And so working together with the two teams, as much as we work with the figure painters and the rules writers and the game designers, is creating an overall product or piece of work which works in harmony all the way through. Their work should support my work, my work should support their work, give and take, all this sort of stuff. And that's what makes our position in our company or in our studios really interesting against a lot of other places, is we make everything in this building, everything. The guys downstairs come up with an idea, they'll concept it through drawings, they will then sculpt it, the figure guys will get in on top of the figure painters, they will paint the things, it'll come up to our studio, we'll be working on the artwork, the rules, the writing, the boxes are then made to put these things in, and then the guys sell it in the shop, and it just goes around different rooms and departmental. It's, you know, in one world.
Yep.
And there is no magic. It's just made by people.
It's all magic.
It's the magic of hard working.
Yes. Passionate people.
Of people, yeah. But it's just guys and girls doing stuff. And anyone can do that. If you put the mindset into it, you can find work here and be part of that process. There's nobody involved in our studios that isn't part of the design process.
No.
Everyone's opinion matters.
Yep.
Everyone's got an opinion. You can choose to ignore it if you don't like it. You can choose to trump it with more experience. But everyone has an opinion. And that's what makes the good stuff, being allowed to give your idea over to somebody else and let them elaborate on it, or take someone else's idea and not feel like, well, I don't really feel like it's mine anymore. Of really getting into the joy of working in a team is great. Mm-hmm. I mean, there'll be a lot of people I work with who go, that's rubbish. Well, you don't do that. You just shout at people when you don't complain about things in the club.
Sorry, present the better story here for VoxCast. That's fine.
Okay,
this is the public.
Okay.
The public.
We'll do another one.
The Hollywood story.
And another thing.
Well, maybe we've talked about maybe coming in with other members of the art team.
Yeah,
or maybe hooking up cameras and having a little scribbling session.
Yeah, and I think there's a lot to be said which we haven't spoken about, which is actual print illustration. In the wider entertainment art world, that's not spoken about enough. And it's workshops one of the few places that really does that well. And there's not enough time to go into all of that now. But
give us the headlines.
Well, it's understanding how the artwork is there not to be just artwork. Mm. It's there to illustrate a book. The writing is not there just to write your big novel. It's there to work within the game and the artwork and the layout. The unsung heroes of our department are the book designers who actually put the things together.
Yep.
And they are incredibly clever and good at what they do.
Mm-hmm.
But they don't do like front and center stuff. They're not making figures or creating artwork. but without them, the whole thing would topple down, and idiots like me would be going, I've done my picture.
We've got a load of folders of pictures.
Yeah, and what you get is you get like a blank, you get a plastic bag with some like space themes in it, and then a piece of picture on a postcard, and that would be what, that'd be what you get. Yeah. And the game would be like a video of someone telling you how to play it.
Just a double spaced background.
It'll be spelt wrong. and the novel that will go with it will just go on and on and on and on. So without the guys and girls that work in the book design team to build the thing,
yeah,
we'd all fall apart. So props to them.
Absolutely, yeah. Shout out to the book design team.
Yeah, they all let me apply.
We'll get them onto VoxCast or Stormcast. Yeah, I'm sure they'll tell it side
because I mean, you've been there because of doing the behind the scenes work. Is, you know, I'll come up to you with a painting of loads of space marines with nothing on their shoulder pads and go, Wade, what do I draw on this? Because I've got no idea. I've got, in terms of the IP, I've got an understanding of the tone and how to interpret the narrative and how this character behaves against this character. The name of this planet, of like, of what different Tau battle suit thing goes with what, I don't know. Because there's only so much I can understand,
yeah.
Because I gave up my education and drew pictures. and loads of those lot I've got them because they've put all these books together. The amount of times they've done painting guides for space marine shoulder pads and heraldry stuff and this planet, and, you know, because like, well, they know which planet it is because they made the map.
Yeah, they've seen it and had it edited and remade.
Yeah, so without them there holding us together with a lead. Mm. We'd beat each other up all the time.
And the editors as well. It's probably less of a factor for the artwork, but yeah, alongside the book production teams to take all of that stuff and make sure it's actually correct when it's finished.
Yeah, so they not physically, but exist on like a turret on the other side. So the art department is like a turret here and there, sort of turret there. So we don't really, in terms of our workflow, we don't interact with them at all. Mm. Nice people.
Yeah.
But yeah, they don't come up to me and tell me I spelt the thing on that flag wrong. And vice versa.
And you don't tell them they're rubbish at drawing because it just doesn't come up very often.
No, because
they might be, but you're nice.
People in glass houses. Yeah.
Have you learned anything in particular from, is there like any style or any feature of the 41st millennium that you struggled to draw that someone else showed you, or have you copied someone else's designs on things in particular?
I think because I grew up loving the artwork, I tend to work in very much in the bracket of some of the people that still work here or have worked here before me. I think it's very difficult for someone to talk about what their style is because you don't know. It's just the way that you do it. Mm. You know, style is limitation. My style is all the things that I don't do. It is, you know, it's. I don't think there's very few people who make a conscious decision to work in a certain style, less in a certain genre, anything like that. So there's people in our art team who stand out as having a unique look, like Mark, for example, Mark Holmes, who does a lot of the brilliant cover artwork for what we do. He really stands out. I was like, every time we see a Mark picture, it's like, yeah, that's Mark's picture, and it's great. You know, he's done the Death Guard cover and the Blight Kings cover and stuff like that, and the brilliant piece of artwork. I can't draw in that style. I can't. Maybe I could if I try to affect what he does, but he's not affecting it. That's just his natural way of drawing. And he'll come and look at my picture and go, have you done that? Have you put all those people in that space time? It's like, well, that's just the way I do it. I solve my problems by attacking it with art. He solves his problems in a different way by attacking it with a really deep understanding of draftsmanship and painting. He's got a really clever approach to it. And again, with Kev's artwork is mind-bogglingly great, and he just has such a unique Kev style. Mm. But I have to ask him. But I don't know that it's a decision he makes to draw. It's just the way that he draws. And I've seen his sketchbook work and his life drawings and whatever, and that's just the way he draws. Mm-hmm. So for him, that's, you know, it's great to imagine that's the world that Kev sees when he looks at
something. Nice, wasn't it?
Yeah. Yeah. So that means the way that I see things must be like a chaotic mess all the time. Probably true. But in terms of the things that we've learned, the art department is a brilliant place to work because everybody's so aware of the skill that's in the department, the skill that came before us in the legacy of workshops artwork, and then the work that exists currently in the rest of the art world. And then we've fortunately got thousands of years of art history to look back on. So for anyone to sit there and go, I'm a brilliant illustrator, it's a very, very rare thing to do, because you can always go, well, this guy, he's really good as well. So there's a really good, dare I say, humble approach to sharing and feedback and giving information. Every time someone learns something, they share it with everybody else. And we look at each other's artwork and offer suggestions and wait for them to leave the room and laugh. And I'm sure they're upstairs laughing at the rubbish that I'm doing at the moment. But he's really great in terms of like my development as an artist, illustrator, whatever. It just rocketed as soon as I started working here alongside people who I'd grown up with drawing their artwork, and they're just guys and girls, and it's great because they're just people and they'll talk to you about stuff. Mm. And it's good fun.
What's the best thing about working in the Warhammer 40,000 studio right now?
At the moment, we have got a really nice set of a really nice approach to the freedom of allowing the art department to do some cool stuff. A lot of trust from other places in the studio to go, yeah, you guys have proved that you can have a bit of loose rope there. Mm. And that's our loose rope to play with, how we will, and it's dangerous. So it's got to go well. But that sometimes that bit of fear of going, okay, they've let me do what I want. Finally, no one's stopping me from doing my massive idea. Oh no,
what is it?
I best deliver on this. Yeah. So yeah, that's really good at the moment. And the drive that a lot of us have got in self-development is brilliant. So my favourite things to do are to sit around with my art colleagues and draw stuff, bringing a life model in, going out sketching over a weekend, going down to see galleries, talking about some new art that we've seen. Someone's got a new art book, someone's ordered a new pen, someone's got a new set of paints, and it's like that childish glee of going like, crayons, cool, you have not tried drawing with crayons, oh wow, they're brilliant. Yeah, finger painting, it's just, yeah. So that's the real excitement and fun I get out of my job. That's the point when it's not a job. It's this is what I'll be doing anyway. And I'll go home and I do more drawing. Mm. So the sweet spots, you go in, oh, I've got a nice comfy chair to sit in while I'm doing this. Otherwise, I'll be home in the cold. Mm. Yeah, but it's the same. It's the same approach. So that's it.
So the best thing about the studio at the minute is crayons. Cool.
Yeah, actually.
Yeah, that's revelatory. Thank you very much for your time.
Pleasure, mate.
And yeah, hopefully we can invite you back on in the future sometime, maybe with some pens and paper and crayons.
Yes, yeah, I'd love to do some drawing.
Do some live art, that'd be awesome, thank you.
I'll have to prove that I can do it.
Yeah. Cool, cheers, Phil.
Pleasure.
Thanks again to Phil, and thank you for watching or listening to the podcast. VoxCast will be back in another 2 weeks, and there'll be an episode of Stormcast released next week. In the meantime, you can check out the Warhammer TV Facebook page for details of other shows that we do, or to leave any feedback about the podcasts. See you soon.